presentation
was supposed to be given by Stig Helveg from Halvor Topsø on the use of electron microscopy for different applications. But unfortunately, there's a Lufthansa pilot strike. So Stig sent me a mail Friday evening that he would not be able to come here, which is of course very unfortunate. But fortunately, we had one of the suppliers of the microscopes here at the conference, and he graciously agreed to give Stig's presentation after some consultation. And I'm pleased to introduce Jörg, who will give Stig's presentation. Yes. We can find it.
Okay, thanks for the nice introduction. So I have to add. So my name is Jörg Jinschek. I work for the, as mentioned before, I work for FDI company, which makes electron microscopes. And we have a strong collaboration with Topsys, so I'm mostly familiar with also the catalysis work, but I have to apologize. My main background is physics and electron microscopy. Second remark is I'm also a personal friend of Stig and collaborate also on other issues. So I hope I can step in and give you most of the comments from Stig, but some of the critical questions you might have to address directly to him. Just as a disclaimer in the beginning. So I principally got Stig's original presentation, so I will go through the slides and present you his work and also the comments. I had some of the text comments which are coming directly from him. So in principle, I'm really presenting it on his behalf. I learned also that the first image already has some value to this audience. That is the inside look of a reactor. So you see a reactor from the inside. And more or less what we try to do in electron microscopy is to see, can you miniaturize it to the level of a nanoreactor? We can do the same studies on the nanoscale using the advantage of electron microscopy. So the next slide shows the next sheet. Why we're all here. I learned it's an early picture of this. And 1971, which is maybe also one of the early pictures of in situ microscopy, because we're using some lenses to look inside the reactor to study more or less in an experiment what happens, what goes on. And then I learned also that's a famous quote of him, so you learn more about life by looking through a keyhole. And interpretation from, I mean, this is Stig what you put it in, but my interpretation is you also mean microscopy. Especially for having an honor symposium, and also on behalf of Stig, special thanks for continuously supporting the electron microscopy work at Halvor Topsø ex situ and in situ. So there's a special thank you to Stig, and it's really very sorry that he could not be in person. On the other hand, I mean, the other alternative would have been that the talk would have been cancelled, so I tried to step in and to do my best. Okay. So from the perspective is, you saw the initial idea that he would like to study catalysis in situ. He would like to learn what happens on the actual catalyst, and there's also some opportunities for microscopy. It's mainly also driven that on computational sites, they're speeding up. They can then go down to the molecular level, the single surfaces, and in the theory, they can predict more or less what goes on at different steps when you have a catalytic reaction and why certain reactions go in a certain way, explaining, for instance, with the energy level. But there's also still the question, because that's what I learned, it's theory has also its limitations. We assume this surface, and you describe, let's say, how molecules are attaching to the site. But how can you relate it then maybe to the active side of a real catalyst, which is more or less like a nanoparticle with multiple facets? How do you combine the theory and the experiment? So what you can do, what's the interplay between both? So then of course it gives you some challenges for microscopy to speed up, because theory can go all the way down to molecular level. So we have to go through microscopy all the way to the same length scale to answer some of the questions which we theory can do. So the first question is, can you observe surfaces, active sites, and maybe even molecules at the atomic level, and have the sensitivity to say this is this or this. Another question is, can we not only do it in static mode, which describes more or less like maybe a dead catalyst, but can we also study this in situ, the dynamics of such a reaction? Can we see the changes of the catalyst according to different settings? So can we correlate the structure and the properties of a catalyst on the same scale? this dynamic field, but also Boolean and dynamic that we have. We go with the frequency of the internal frequency of a balanced reaction. So in the end, the final goal will be that you don't do experimental theory, but you have an interplay between both. And ideally, we would like to correlate one with each other at the same length scale. So again, it's an opportunity for microscopy, but it's still a challenge. So let's focus on the transmission electron microscopy. I know there's all the other techniques here, so in situ, STEM, STM microscopy. So here we focus on transmission electron microscopy. It's a principal setup. What we have is you use an electron beam, which is under high vacuum condition. You put your catalyst in, which is known as crystalline, so it's presented there by the model with atoms. You use a lens and you try to magnify it millions of times to really see a nanoparticle in focus and study surfaces, structure, shape. But you have to remember that you look everything in projection. So you see on the lower right side, that's a gold catalyst, support. You see a gold particle, but these dark blobs don't represent generally a single atom, it's a column of atoms. So it's a projection seen there from a row of atoms in under certain projection. So you have more or less like a shadow image of a 3D object on a 2D plane. In some rare cases, you can see single atoms, but it's still a challenge because you need to sample in a certain way and you also need very sensitive detectors. I stepped in, this is one slide which I put in because it also explains nicely how electron microscopy or microscopy in general progressed over the years. So you see, of course, it started with light microscopy, but there's a natural limit to light microscopy. It's more or less the wavelengths of the photons you're using. So then, a bit of the last century, we developed the electron microscope. It didn't have the better resolution back then, but there's a great potential because the natural wavelengths of electrons are much shorter, so the picometer range. So we have the chance to get all the way down to the atomic level. And then, of course, they improved these electron microscopes. They increased their attention to get better resolution. You see that in 1 millionth microscope. But then they had another level, so which was just before the Onyx-2 level. So you couldn't go better, but it's not based on the physics. It's more or less on the quality of the lenses you can build. So there's also some improvement in electronics, but more or less you hit a barrier. And if you want to go really atomic resolution, you have to do the next step, which was mid of the last decade, or took about a decade. So in principle, we put glasses on these lenses, and we build aberration correction. So in principle, we improved step by step the quality of the optical system of an electron microscope, and now we reach sub-angstrom resolution. So I think the record is about a low 0.5-angstrom resolution. We don't always need this one, but you also gain signal-to-noise at 1-angstrom level, in principle, the microscope can reach 0.5-angstrom. So we can push the limits there. This is just a brief explanation of what we are talking about when we say aberration correction. So you see on the upper right, upper left side, here's the ideal lens, and you can make it with glass, like an aspheric lens. You have no aberrations. So everything is focusing in one point. So you really can have one blob as the picture of an atom. In reality, we have spherical aberration, which means the beams which are close to the optical axis have the right focus. Beams which are further away from the optical axis focus converges. So in principle, when you make a cut now through this plane, you will see a disk, which we can describe as a widespread function. And then on top, we of course have also chromatic aberrations. So if you use electrons with slightly different energy, you focus also a different point, but that's another topic. Let's focus on the spheric aberration and the widespread function, and it's nicely cartooned on the right-hand side. So you see the early generation microscope, CNC-100, which doesn't have the aberration correction. You see a catalyst, and you have these fringes extending into the vacuum. So you see size and shape, but you cannot really say where the surface is. That simply comes because you have this overlapping Hoyle-Sprott function. So back when you image the next atom, you still have influence on the atom before, more or less. So you blur the image, and you don't get really a sharp picture. There's no way of doing this with focusing or anything. There's some way of software using to calculate this, but straight away for dynamic experiments, you would like to correct it in microscope. That's seen on the right-hand side, so we put the glasses on the lens, and then see, you get a final point for the function. Now you can really image atom by atom, and you get much sharper picture. And you also see in projection the surface of your catalyst. So you can even identify what's going on and even shifts on the surface if there's a surface reconstruction. Okay. These are some examples from Stick's work with different collaborators, mainly with the Superstring and Last Group, and the Berkeley Lab, different microspaces. But I'm sure you can see here how they push the limit in microscopy doing an industrial catalyst, which is MRS2. Here it contains some cobalt promoter atoms. They're using the different techniques. They look at the different edges, which were identified as the active sites of this catalyst. And you see on the left-hand side, it's a stem image of the molybdenum edge. And you see a bronze sulfur atom sitting there in the line, which is predicted by theory. And then on the right-hand side, we did imaging spectroscopy on the sulfur edge. And you can clearly see in the spectrum that all the promoter atoms are adding up or lining up on the sulfur edge. So this is pushing really the limit of microscopy in terms of imaging and spectroscopy to see on a single atom level where the atoms are. This is a nice example because also it's a very nice object for microscopy because it's a 2D material, so it's a very one sheet. You need a nice substrate, usually they use graphene, but it's still a pristine catalyst. And they use the advantage that you more or less can count how many atoms you have in the column. So it's labeled in the column. So really the red block is one cobalt atom, the orange one is one sulfur, the yellow one is two sulfur, and the blue is one molybdenum. So you can count atoms, which is also good to calibrate your technique if you already know what to predict. Next step is saying, okay, this is all fine, you're pushing it into microscopy, but as mentioned before, you might not look at the real catalyst because you image an object, which is a nanoparticle, but it's not active. So it needs to be at elevated temperature or under gas conditions to really show the real shape, the real size, the real structure of the catalyst when it's active. So of course, this gives the need for a in situ study, or if you look into the reactor to see what really happens. So these are all different reasons why you want to do that, because the catalyst has a lifetime. So it might be deactivated by sintering, it has maybe some carbon removed, it goes through variations of shape during the life, and you would like to link that to the activity of the catalyst. Your phase changes, so you name it. And this all happens when the catalyst is alive at work, but this usually not happens in the microscope. Then out of Topsy, when I learned, Jens was really, in favor of this and helping to start this collaboration also. Back then it was Philips, now it's FBI company, and over the years, so we from the microscope manufacturer, we listened to what Topsy wanted, and we built two special microscopes. One, actually both are still in operation. One is the Lipton 99, which is now converted to self-experiment, and the latest generation of our ETHEM, seen on the right-hand side, where we combine ETHEM technology, so it allows gas in the system by a differential pumping system, and we combine it with the latest technology in optics with deposition direction to really push the limit and resolution you can see in situ. And of course, there's also development in the holders, you see the lower, so they are also miniaturized because then you can go to higher temperature because that's the other thing. So you would like to go with the gas pressure, but you also need to have elevated temperature very precisely, minimize drift to meet more or less to get the potential out of the microscope, which can show you single atoms. Okay, this for instance, I'm a collaborator, so we published this together. It's a very busy slide. The main message I would like to give you here, you still have to think about the beam interaction between the interaction between the electron beam, the gas, and the substrate, which is also important, first of all, to really look at the catalysis and not just the beam effects, but it also has a consequence how the images will look. So if you look at the upper part, we use two different dose rates. I don't have one. So what we did is we did something very boring for catalyst people, but very interesting for microscopy people. So we took a gold on a cross grating, so it's gold particles sitting on carbon film, and we exposed it to nitrogen. So nothing should happen. So actually, we want to have a stable system, but we want to see the effect of the gas in the microscope. This is more or less the same image with the same object, the same pressure, so no pressure in the microscope, but we varied the dose rate. So we used an order of magnitude less electrons per area per second. In this experiment, you see the inherent resolution of the microscope is there, but you see the difference if you then expose it to 20 millibar. So this is with this high dose rate, you see 20 millibar, almost the entire resolution is gone. So there's no structure. See, on the atomic scale, there's no structure seen anymore. the other hand, you have this very noisy image. Signal to noise is very lousy. But you see still these spots. So here, the resolution of the microscope is there. What tells you this? You have to maybe end up with microscope images like this, noisy, not very beautiful, not so crisp. But here you prevent the action between the beam, the gas, and the specimen. So the specimen is still at its natural state and not excited because of some interactions. So it might be that you look at very nice papers, but the images look more noisy. But that's the main message. And then we figure out that in this level, you're not limited by the resolution from the microscope, but rather by another criteria, which is the detector limitations. So you need a certain signal to noise. Certain signal to noise, you have a certain resolution, which is called the Rose criterion. So in the end, when the system would allow a longer exposure time, you can have more extreme resolution in these settings, but usually when you have dynamic experiments, it's not possible, so you might not have the full resolution of the microscope available when you do dynamic studies. I also was asked to put this in. This is the earlier publication from the top series, also with Jan involved. And here it was described before. Here you see the risk of growth, the surface, so zoomed in to the nickel particle, so a little higher magnification than the image we saw before. And you see immediately how the surface changes with the steps. And also the steps are then the origin of the carbon film, or the carbon layer, which is growing. Do not forget, so I put it in, a remark for me, so you see the, on the surface of the nickel, you see one atomic step, actually here, which is about 2x from high, and then more or less this is the origin of the carbon growth. I know it's an unwanted product in your application, even for me, but it's one of the first movies where you could see in the microscope the product catalytic reaction, so it's a solid. But you see how the gas is converted into a carbon film. But also you see two limitations in this experiment. First of all, this has been done at a very low pressure, because this is the limitation of those microscopes which I described before. To maintain the high vacuum requirement in the gun and in the camera area, we can only go up to 20 millibar in the sample area. Towards the window to image, so that's the one limitation you have with this microscope. And of course, this is an unwanted product, it's a byproduct from the chemical reaction. Ideally, you have only gases as a product, so then you would like to have a technical, let's say, experimental setup where you can also see gas changing, that you really have to, assure that the catalytic reaction happens in the microscope. So that's why they're working in a, there was a long-standing work, actually I think it took more than 10 years, in the Netherlands. It was mainly a collaboration with the TU Delft, FDI company, talks with other partners in this consortium called Real Nano or NIMIC. So what they did is, they used the concept of having these catalysts under gas environment, but they realized that it's not good enough to just place them in a regular microscope, you have to do something more. And back then they developed these MEMS technologies, so you can miniaturize structures on a silicon chip, not only for electronic applications, but also for microfluid, and in this specific case for gas application. So this is an actual image of those devices. You see it's about, say, about 1 centimeter wide, a couple of centimeters long. Here's a structure, you see the length of the gas channel, so this is inside the silicon chip, this is where the gas will come. Will come in here on the bottom. Okay. So the gas will feed in here. So this is the same chip, it's from the upper part, that's the lower part. The gas will come in here, then it goes through this channel, through this area where you have the catalyst, and goes right here. So you have really a linear flow into this nanoreactor. You see on the back side, they etched away the silicon and left a very thin window on the bottom and top of silicon nitride to make it electron transparent because you still want to image it. This is the top side, you see there's a small structure in which is these are metal wires inside the silicon for heating, so you can heat it as well. This is now a cross section, it's about 5 micrometer. So more or less then you have a ballpark figure. You reduce the gap, the gas gap, which you have in a microscope by an order of magnitude from 5 millimeter to 5 micrometer, which would you allow in the same resolution to extend the gas pressure also by an order of magnitude, so you go from 1 millibar to 1 bar. This is actually what you want, because I've learned that when you talk about catalysis, everything happens at a 1 bar when you have higher pressure. And there's still some limitation that you cannot go over that pressure, because from the structure you still need some thin bins of silicon nitride, which are actually here. They require electron transparency that you can really use the microscope to see a catalyst live. So this gives you some upper limitation of the pressure you can use, but at least you're now in 1 bar level. And then maybe some technical details, those are some pillars here. Because of course, if you evacuate this reactor, the windows would probably collapse. And if you pressurize, they would bulge. But they put these pillars in to more or less prevent this, so there should be a very stable thickness. This is now from the top. You see the heating electrode, this is the heating spiral, these small holes are these windows on top, and they are lined on the top and the bottom, so you can really look through the electron beam. The aligned windows, and it is zoomed into one of the windows. So, stick it using a Mac, I'm using a PC, so I lost some of the simpler micrometers. So you see here, and the breaking platinum fine particles zooming in. That's what actually is showing in. I think it should be the 100 nanometers, yes. You see different sizes of these platinum particles on these windows. So you image through the two windows and you see particles. And now, this is one of these particles image. 1 bar pressure under those conditions is a 0.02 certain ratio of helium. You see, you can still see that it's fringes in the atomic resolution. So the point is here that, of course, you cannot now reduce the ultimate resolution of the microscope. This is something real, the actual conditions of the apply 1 bar pressure. Like I said, I'm not a catalyst person, so I'm a high-resolution microscopist. The famous oscillation reaction, we more or less study the CO oxidation, that's the formula, and platinum is 1.0. And then you have a rate of the reaction product which oscillates, which correlates nicely with two different surface reconstruction of the specific surface. I think I wrote it down here because, again, I'm sorry about this one, but this explains more or less the cycle. So, when you have this one reconstruction, it's lifted by the CO absorption, which is very strong, and as a result, you get the other reconstruction. This absorbs the oxygen better than the previous reconstruction, then the CO pressure and the coverage falls, and then it more or less runs into the cycle that destabilizes this one reconstruction with respect to the other one. And then when you do the calculation measurements, you see when you use oscillating structure, you also get an oscillating outcome of the reaction product. Now the question from this surface study, which is done at also lower pressure, what then happens in the when you have a real catalyst nanoparticle, not just an extended surface, but a real catalyst with multiple facets, and what happens to the different surfaces, and what's the effect of when it applies to a 1 bar nanoreactor, when you do this experiment in the 1 bar nanoreactor. Most of the questions from your side might be on the catalytic side, so I put a slide here. This is published in Nature Materials, this is a reference, so some of the questions I have to refer to the supporting information in that paper. But this is what it was really done. So what the holy grail would be, we can use the imaging through the microscope under realistic conditions. But you also get a response from the nanoreactor, because you can use it as a nanocalorimeter, so you can see if it's an exothermic reaction by seeing if you need more or less power for heating up this nanoreactor. And at the same time, you can go on a small volume, you can directly plug in a mass spectrometer and measure if you have a reaction product. So this was done here, so this is the imaging, you can make a time resolve, so you just capture a movie. You might can capture structural changes. At the same time, you can use a mass spec, and you see the order of magnitude you can capture here. So in the time resolve TM, it's in the order of the study on the 0.1 to 1 second exposure time of images. The mass spec is a little bit more delayed because, of course, you have this long tubing from the order, from the nanoreactor to the through the order to the mass spec, so there's a little bit longer response time in the mass spec. And then, of course, with the setup of this heating, you have also a built-in nanometer within a lot of milliseconds that you can see if this, if you need more power to keep the temperature constant or not. So that we have a response if there's an exothermic reaction. Okay, now to get really busy. So what they did is, of course, they did the experiment, but at the same time, they modeled the reactor performing, including the heat equation for temperature field, but also a mass transport equation, which assumed a steady-state reaction, and then the balance between diffusion convection against the reaction conversion. So then, this was based on this model, they did the calculation, that's the yellow and the red line, and then you see the experimental parameters. So if you look at the round plot, that's when they ramp up the reactors with increasing temperature, and when they slow it down or cool it down, is that the triangle ones that matches pretty well the stimulant. When you zoom further in, at the end, you see you have actually two states which could be measured and described, and you end up with a bistable reactor, which means that at a certain temperature, you should be able to see both states. So this is then the experiment, zoom in. So this is now the structured image. This is the reaction power, that means you keep a constant temperature, and the reactor tells you, does it need more power or less to keep the temperature? So you get a direct response if there's an exothermic reaction. And at the same time, you can see from the mass spec the conversion from CO to CO2. This is pretty sharp because you measured locally where the catalysts are. This is a bit delayed and more or less blurred because, again, the mass spec, there's some distance between the nanoreactor and the mass spec, and so you see it more or less slightly delayed edge. So if you now look carefully, you see that the catalyst is changing shape. So in certain conditions, it looks more round. You look at this corner, you look at this corner, you look at this corner. In other conditions, it's more or less more faceted. It's actually pulsing. It also tells you a little bit, it cannot be a beam effect because the beam effect would not be reversible. So it's under condition that the beam effect would be negative. So this is more or less a quantitative analysis, so you can define the roundness or facetedness with a morphology factor. Once you assume a certain roundness and then say if it deviates the most, the factor increases to 1, so if you have a square, it would be 1. And you see if you zoom in, you can nicely correlate between the reaction power or the output, or the calorimeter measurement from the nanoreactor. You can nicely correlate it with the shape of the structure of the catalyst. You see from around the square back to round, it's passing. As mentioned before, you should also always be careful if you use an electron beam, that this is not just beam effects and you trigger it or you influence your reaction at too high dose or too high tension. So you have not this flexibility in these systems, more sensitive cameras, more variable high tensions. So here they did a study and varied, like we did before, and measured the resolution. Here they did a study and varied the dose rate. So there's 5 electrons per square axon per second on the specimen. This is 200, and then they measured the output, and you see you get similar behavior. So in principle, you can observe these oscillating behavior under all these conditions. So if you use this one, you're safe, so it's not triggered by the beam. So they told me also then, if you expose it further, I think in order to make it further, or higher dose rate, you need to make it further. How much time is this?
You've got 20.
Okay, thanks. So they did the study under different conditions, and more or less confirmed that you can reproduce with different dose rates, and also oscillating, so it's not a beam effect. But again, you might not end up with a crisp image which you usually experience from an electron microscope because these are really lousy dose rates by resolution images, for instance. This is now at a slightly higher temperature, so it's heated up by 550 Kelvin higher, and now you see much more rapidly these structure changes. See, this is the edge. And it correlates pretty nicely with the oscillation of the reaction power, but suddenly you don't see any effect on it. You see an effect, but a very broad effect on the mass spec. This has something to do that these structural changes are much faster than the mass spec can keep up. So with the mass spec, there's a certain delay time, because you have an extended nanoreactor and you have this long tubing, so before the mass spec can pick it up, the catalyst is already in the nanoscale. But you nicely see the construction. You can also see in the FFT that this you can resolve the lattice fringes of the catalyst. This also helps you then to identify which facets you actually see. So you can use this orientation, so you know the distances and the orientation of the colors. You can do this analysis and you see these are the 1-1-1s, which when you're in the faceted state, they extend all the way, so you have a 1-1-1-1-1. And if it's more round, that's almost parallel to the 1-1-0, but it's more or less a step, but we have also higher ordered index like 2-1-1, 3-1-1. So I mean, this needs to be also something we could study also from the crystallography. But more or less you see that it jumps between these two states, which one is the round and the other one is more square. Okay, now we're really for me. So the explanation also could be, well, the explanation in the paper is that you can refer also back to DFT calculations. So they more or less assume that in the square shape that you have this extended planar one-on-one surfaces, which has a certain coverage of CO and O2, and it's calculated here, versus the partial pressure of CO. And if you have this round shape, you assume you have step two on two-on-one surfaces, which is also part of this calculation. So if you look at the upper one, you see the coverage of CO on the different facets, on the 2-on-1 like this. You can have a very high coverage at a certain pressure. For instance, in the microscope, you usually have 10 millibar. And you barely see anything from the CO at the 1-on-1, which is just creeping up here. So it's really all on the other hand, if you have now a lower pressure of CO, you would jump to this square shape, it's going to be much higher coverage of the oxygen. The interesting thing here is that more or less when you can see the calculation of the rate, that would explain also why we have these different coverages, because the different shapes will, let's say, absorb CO differently, and then you will have a diffusion of CO on the surface locally, and then when you have a higher, let's say, if you have less bonding, you have an excess of CO, and more or less you generate locally the condition that it's fluctuating between these two pressure and local pressure ranges. So more or less the catalyst experience a flip-flop between, for instance, 10 millibar and 1 millibar locally. So although you have the same pressure inlet, but locally with the changes of these behaviors, you create locally a varying of the local carbon monoxide pressure. Okay, and there's also the question saying, is this seen all over the non-reactor? You can look at these varying windows, so more or less when you look at the flow, the gas comes from the left, so these are original gases, the reaction product. So you can also look at the catalysts which are at the beginning, or the entrance of your reactor. You can look at catalyst particle at the exit of your reactor, and you see the nose changes on the beginning. So you don't observe this oscillating when there's fresh gas coming in. So the first layer of catalyst doesn't experience this shape change, but you see it very pronounced at the exit. So more or less you have also layer by layer, different, let's say, ratio between the gases in the reaction zone. So the particles along the reaction zone experience different gas composition. It's also observed. So with the time between these two movies, about 30 minutes, because you have to set up the microscope that you instead of imaging this window, you have to image this window. But again, there's a correlation between this observation and the mass spec and the. I forgot to mention before. These measurements, of course, integrate over the entire reactor, so this is not local. So then they fit everything they measured and they know from theory together in one model. So the models they used, the model described before with this convection diffusion model. They know from DFT that you have these two sides which have a different behavior of CO coverage and also conversion rate. And in addition, they included, or let's say they allowed the shape change, which is described as the factor of alpha, which more or less the proportion of one-on-ones you exhibit or not. And when you feed all of this in this model, you come up with this result. So first of all, only when you include also the shape dynamics, you can simulate the pressure behavior at the mass spec. And the second thing is, this is a very complicated graph, but in this line, you have the resistance times of this carbon monoxide molecule in the reactor, so it's the calibration. In this direction, you have the length of the reaction stream, that is, so it's the entry of the reactor and the exit. And in this, or let's say the third dimension, the green color is more or less the shape. So you start with black, the round, and then it's green, it's squared. So then you see, in the entrance, the catalyst is expected, or even is measured. The entrance, all the catalysts don't change the shape, they're all round. And at the exit, a certain time frame, which is this oscillation, you see it flips between round and square shape. So then in the end you measure the average over the entire reaction, so that the mass spec, and then you get this oscillating behavior of the CO conversion to CO2. I hope I'm still good in time. So conclusion is that I hope I was convincing to show you that microscopy came a long way, especially electron microscopy, so we can push the limits. Not at the moment, not still at the same time, so we can go with special microscope to half an X-ray resolution with certain, say, in situ holes, we can go to one atmosphere. Of course, we have to also then use these new constants, or we can use these new constant instrumentation, especially for catalysis, not only for catalyst imaging. So we can image these nanoparticles with single-atom sensitivity, like this MOS2 case. We can monitor these nanoparticle dynamics in reactive gases, either at low pressures with the ETEM or high pressure with these holders. Now, finally, we can also correlate atomic structure changes and the activity of your catalyst, because you can measure it at the same time. Yeah, and in the end, the overall theme is that with this setup, we can slowly close the pressure and materials gap, which was really before there in the in situ techniques, so that you have either you use the real material, but you can also use it as a low pressure, or you can use higher pressure and you have to use a model material, and with this setup, you can finally bring it together to close these gaps. So thank you very much. Last but not least, Stig wants to thank a lot of these collaborators, especially his team in our top space, especially Jens, to make this all happen. And then you see over the years, he collaborated with a lot of groups. So for instance, here in the Netherlands, which is where I'm from, so that's money. And also, of course, different microscopy centers, for instance, Berkeley and Glasbury, and all the other groups also on STM. Theory, some people are known from Stanford, and also the Nanoscience Center at Copenhagen University. Thank you very much. And
thank you very much for stepping in and giving this fantastic award. Questions from the audience? Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for very interesting presentation, in particular on the oscillation of the platinum particles. I think platinum process expected these phenomena to take place in practical catalysts, and you're approaching that now with these studies. But it raises also a lot of questions. So to name one, the electron dose. So could you bring back the slides where you vary the electron dose? You said, well, that has no impact.
Really?
Yes, this one. There's a lot of information here, but if I compare the bottom figure and for the different colors that is linked to the electron dose rate, I see huge differences.
Yeah. And I have to ask the one basic argument is saying if you see this oscillating behavior, so then the beam effect cannot be dominant because beam effects would be changing
but
the structure.
But you agree that the beam effect induces enormous power differences in the frequency and everything.
Yeah, I have to look into this in detail, so I don't see it.
Well,
it's
actually really busy. Detail from a distance, huh?
Yeah. So what you mean is, isn't this one is part
yeah, the light blue
this
versus
distance
the
versus
the dark blue.
So you mean, for instance, the difference in time.
So, okay, then. The other thing is that we have a very broad particle size distribution.
Mm-hmm.
So I would expect that the frequency of oscillations are related to the size of the particle. So, and that brings up the question, why are all the particles be in phase in the system to bring about an overall reactor output oscillation?
So you mean not only in phase because of the position in the reactor, but also
the position, the size,
position.
So why are the particles in phase? Apparently,
position was
overall
yes.
Variation in the CO2 output.
So the position was taken into account in this simulation, so it shows already that they should have a different behavior. It's the entrance of the position in the reactor. So this is at zero, this model is on that side of the reactor. So this is the reaction zone, that's the exit, so you should see differences when you take. Like there's a difference between this movement and this movement, which was taken in the reactor. But you're asking also the difference in the size.
for example, size position.
Yeah. So position, I think, is an answer with the size after us. That's probably they looked into it, but maybe it's not provided in this talk.
Yes?
Something of a more fundamental question, but the atoms that show go forward and back, where are they coming from? I mean, you're not creating matter. They must come from somewhere, and then there must be a void somewhere else, or they come the whole.
I think the volume of the particle stays the same, but you see the projection. So they might be. I mean, you go from that corner, and you develop different facets, more or less truncated, but the projection it seems it's gone.
So the different. Other side of the particle is getting changed in a different way.
No, it's you have the thing in third dimension. So they're not. You have the thing in third dimension. So yeah. This is just a projection, and they can also move on the surface to the out of focus and form these 2-1-1 facets. I mean, well, I have to look up how.
So the atoms are coming from the surface.
Yeah, they're
rearranging. They're coming.
Exactly.
Moving across the surface.
Yes, because they form a 1-1-1, and then they 1-0, 2-1-1. So they're hopping on the surface to reset different positions, but. The overall crystal structure of the catalyst stays the same. If they would be leaving the surface, that would not be reversible. You would see it shrinking.
Okay. So you're suggesting that the atoms on the surface are moving like this?
Yes. The other movie is also an E-term where you see a crystalline catalyst. I think if you would see the original movie, which was presented before, these catalysts look almost like liquids. So when you have these observations, they're changing shape and grow nanowires and other examples. It seemed before that although it's decrystalline, they very rapidly change their shape. And I think we just missed